Welcome back, everybody, to part three of my interview with Jim Keaton, president of the Helen Reddy Official Fan Club. My name is Harvey Brownstone, and it's my pleasure to welcome Jim back again. Thank you for doing this for us, Jim.
Well, thank you very much for having me. And before we get started, I need to correct an error of fact from our last interview. I was playing it back, and I said when I was talking about Imagination that there was a single that should have been released from that album called Save Me. Well, the Save Me did not appear on that album. It appeared on Play Me Out, which was the first MCA album. So I just want to correct that for the record.
Well, you have a lot of fans who are very knowledgeable about every detail, so I'm sure they get right on to you if they hear one inaccuracy. But you're forgiven.
Well, thank you.
Jim, I want to tell you the feedback from parts one and two were so overwhelming. There was such a flood of a positive reaction to your interview. I just wanted to know from you, how did you take all that?
Well, first of all, I want to say that it's not about me. It's about Helen. And I want to make sure that people focus on that. I am thrilled to be able to share my experiences and my stories about Helen with people who may not know as much about her as they would like to. So that makes me feel really, really good. I also am really flattered that people want to hear what I have to say. So I'm available when you want me to talk.
Well, Jim, everybody is interested in hearing what you have to say. And on that note, I want everyone watching to know both Jim and I received tons of questions from fans that they want me to ask. I'm going to do my very best to get to all of them. And we both thank you very much for all of the feedback, all of the questions. It's just an absolute joy, Jim, to have this chance to talk with you and to know that Helen Reddy fans are soaking all of this up, because there's so many questions people have about her life, her career, her song choices, which leads me to my first question.
Yeah.
Helen, for some reason, recorded several songs about weird women. Yes. Angie Baby.
You live your life in the songs you hear on the rock and roll radio. And when a young girl doesn't have any friends, that's a really nice place to go. Folks hoping you'd turn out cool, but they had to take you out of school. You're a little touched, you know, Angie Baby. Lovers appear in your room each night and they whirl you across the floor. But they always seem to fade away when your daddy taps on your door. Angie girl, are you all right? Tell the radio good night. All alone once more, Angie baby.
Ruby red dress. Delta Dawn.
Delta Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he was a meeting you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky? She's 41. Still calls a baby. All the folks round Brownsville say she's crazy, 'cause she walks downtown with her suitcase in her hand.
What do you think that's about?
Well, she called that her crazy ladies medley. And what I find interesting about all of that is they were some of her biggest hits. So clearly they were hitting a button somewhere. One of the best questions that Helen used to get, and I loved her answer to it, was, what do the lyrics to Angie Baby mean? And she used to say, well, what do they mean to you? Because I think if you can explain to them what they mean to you, there's a paper to be written about that. It's a psychological exercise, if you ask me. And I asked Alan O'Day that same question when I met him, who wrote the song. And he said, well, what do they mean to you? It's just about, in my opinion, so here, get ready to write the paper. It's about a girl who is obsessed with the radio and it becomes her connection to the rest of the world. So that's where she turns when she's lonely and when she needs company.
Well, sometimes when a song becomes a hit, it's a blessing and a curse. And I remember hearing Helen say numerous times in interviews that she couldn't stand singing Ruby Red Dress, Leave Me Alone.
She said that many times. And I think part of that was because people wanted her to sing it. They want to hear the hits. They don't want to hear, you know, the songs that didn't make it to the top 10. They want to hear the hits. That's what they're paying for. And so when Helen performed, if she didn't do Leave Me Alone, it was like, oh God, what's wrong with her? She's not singing the hits. So she felt like she had to. And then when she came back after retirement, she no longer had to. She was making the choices herself. So she used to make it very clear, I'm not going to sing that song again. But what's funny is toward the end, when she was finishing up her touring, she started singing it again.
People Isn't that interesting? Well, I noticed in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s, Leave Me Alone was always part of a medley. She never sang the whole song.
Right. She did that with a lot of them because she used to say, if I sang all my hits or all the songs you want me to sing, we'd be here for days. So I always said, well, good, I'm fine with that. Let's keep going. And so when she put them into a medley, she kind of gave most people a little bit of, at least, of what they wanted. But that song became one that she did not sing fully very quickly.
It was a very catchy tune. Mm-hmm. As for Angie Baby, it's true. Everybody mm-hmm. has their own interpretation of what that's about. I think it could have been turned into a movie, you know, like some of these story songs.
I do too. Actually, it was made into a video, a cartoon-like video, as a video for the song that is very interesting.
To the best of your knowledge, how much control did Helen have over her choice of material?
Well, I think she had, there were songs that were brought to her, given to her, and she would choose whether she was going to sing them or not. Like, there were songs that were brought to her that became big hits for other people, and the other way around, Helen hits that were brought to other artists before they were brought to her. And she chose what she wanted to sing with input from producers and other people that were obviously involved in the business who knew. And there were some songwriters that she really liked. So she would look for material from them to record. So she had a lot of input into the songs. And then once they were recorded, Helen and Jeff and the producers got to listen to the finished product to see how it sounded. And some songs were recorded 3 or 4 times in different ways to see which one they liked best. So I have some acetates, which are usually, they're pressed so the artists can hear what it sounds like. Of, for instance, Rhythm Rhapsody, there's at least 4 different versions of that. And the one that she ended up singing is the one that she liked best.
There are some recordings of Helen's hits that don't sound like the originals.
Mm-hmm.
I have an Alexa, and when I asked Alexa to play Helen Reddy, I got a different versions of Delta Dawn and several others. What's that about?
Well, right after the Mel Torme tour, she wanted to jazz up some of her hits. So she re-recorded them and redid them with a more jazzy tempo. So that's probably what you're hearing.
And do you know which album that is, if people want to buy it?
Feel So Young.
The Feel So Young album.
Yes, it was on her own label and she released it herself. It was sold over the internet. So that's when she decided, I'm going to take control of the recording end of this. And she decided what she was going to do, recorded it, released it, and it did pretty well.
Sometimes after a musical artist passes away, the family or her company find unreleased material that they then release. Do we know if there's any possibility of more Helen Reddy songs to come out?
God, I hope so. Part of the issue with that is the Universal Storage Fire. A few years ago, the masters for a lot of artists were stored, and the fire destroyed plenty of them, and Helen's were some of them. So I don't know exactly what's left. I have on the Rarities from the Capitol Vault CD that was released a few years ago, I have given Jordan all of the unreleased material that I have. So that's been released now. So there's nothing to my knowledge, but I keep hoping.
Yes, I think we all do. Did Helen have good friends in show business?
She did. Olivia Newton-John and Helen were friends. Carol Burnett and Helen were friends. But Helen, one of the things that she used to get asked a lot is, what is it like to be a star? And she grew up in that business. So she used to say, being a star to me meant that I had to do my own laundry. I had to iron my own clothes. I had to get the makeup ready for the show. And I had done that my entire life. So I wasn't impressed with being a star. So most of Helen's closest friends, to my knowledge, were not so-called stars. Some of them were in the business, but her closest circle of friends were people outside the business.
Was that deliberate?
I think, I don't know if it was deliberate, but I think, you know, if you're around, and I'm not saying that all celebrities and all stars have big egos, but a lot of them do. If you're around people that want the attention all the time, it's exhausting. So I think she liked being around people who were so-called normal and didn't expect her to be on all the time and to be performing, you know, all the time and to be the stage Helen Reddy all the time. Another story she used to tell, and people a lot of times don't have boundaries. Paul Newman used to tell a story similar to this, but Helen is in a bathroom. She's using the bathroom and somebody sticks a pen and a piece of paper under the stall to ask her to sign an autograph. It's like, okay, this is not stardom. This is human. I need to take care of a few things first before I do that. Paul Newman had that same issue, standing at a urinal doing his business. Somebody handed him a pen and paper for him to sign an autograph, and he never would do autographs again in public. He would do them at autograph shows and if you wrote to him, but not in public. He didn't find that attractive.
Do you think there was anything about the Hollywood world that she did like? Do you think she liked the red carpet and going to award shows and the paparazzi and all of that?
I think there was an element of it that she liked. And I think that she did enjoy participating in award shows. And it was where she had a chance for her sense of humor to come out. Some of the lines that were written for her or that she just said on award shows were funny. I think she enjoyed it until it got to the point where it interfered with the lives of her children. Sometimes people would not recognize that Helen is there with her children, her son, her daughter, or both. And they would come up to her while they're eating dinner and start talking or asking for autographs or photos. And that's okay. That's part of the business, asking for autographs and photos. But there has to be a line between, this is my personal life and I need this time with my kids and my family. And I can't do this right now. And people didn't want to hear no. So I think that sometimes was I don't want to say a bother, but a frustration.
Jim, I got a lot of questions from people asking about her wardrobe, the choice of clothing for her performances on the stage. It started off, I would say, kind of hippie-ish, tight jeans, kind of knitted tops. And then she became very glamorous.
Yeah.
Do you know who designed for her?
Well, I know that Bob Mackie did some of her dresses, some of those beautiful dresses she wore. I have a couple of her stage worn dresses, and I don't remember who the designers were, but they were named designers. Interestingly, she made the worst dress list at least three times, maybe five.
How did she take that?
It was a joke to her. I mean, she would one of the press conferences where they announced the worst dress list, she wore an orange top and red jogging pants. So if you want to see worse dress, let me show you. It wasn't a big deal to her.
I received also, surprisingly to me, numerous questions about No Way to Treat a Lady.
guess it was yourself you were involved with. I would have sworn it was me. I might have found out sooner if you'd only let me close enough to see. That ain't
There are many women that take offense to the term lady and gentleman, because there's a whole connotation when you describe a woman as a lady that can be off-putting and pejorative and not modern. It's not consistent with someone singing, "I am woman." Did you ever discuss that with her?
I didn't discuss it with her, but I know how she felt about it, because she would talk about it sometimes. To her, the word lady was what you were just saying. It was classy. It was someone who was in control of themselves. It was someone who knew how to act, who had manners, and who deserved respect. If it was used in a pejorative way to her, I never was aware of it. And when Harriet Schock wrote that song, I know that's not how it was meant. It was meant as a compliment.
Moving now on to the movie, I Am Woman.
Yes.
First of all, I must apologize to people. I had many, many emails from people saying, "What movie are you referring to?" I'm sorry. I assumed that people knew that the movie about Helen's life that is on Netflix is called I Am Woman. I apologize.
Yes.
I would like to ask Jim about the premiere at the Toronto Film Festival. Who attended? What happened? What was it like?
Oh, it was wonderful. We were lucky enough to attend, my husband and I. And all the primary stars were there, all the principal, the director, the producers, the writer, everybody there, the principals were all there. It premiered at the Elgin Theater, and that is a wonderful, beautiful old theater. And to my knowledge, it was sold out. Certainly when I went in, we went to a reception before the premiere, and when I went in, I saw no empty seats at all. And then after the premiere, it got a standing ovation. People were thrilled with it. There was a question and answer period, which was very interesting, hearing some of the questions that people ask about how did you decide to pick just three periods of Helen's life? And one of the things about that is you can't, as we talked last time, you can't tell the story of Helen Reddy in 2 hours. So
who was answering these questions?
The director, the producer, the writer, Tilda, who played Helen, Evan, who played Jeff, and Danielle, who played Lillian Roxon, were all on stage answering the questions.
Did the star of the show, of the movie, show up as well?
Tilda?
Yes.
That played Helen? Yes, she is wonderful. She has such a bright career ahead of her. The first time I met her, we just hit it off. She's just a wonderful person. She wanted to get the story right. She wanted to get Helen's movements and the way she presented a song right. And she practiced for weeks before they started filming. So she spent a lot of time working on getting Helen right. The other thing that was very obvious is, especially, I spent most time with Tilda, who played Helen, Danielle, who played Lillian, and Evan, who played Jeff. I spent most time with them. And the chemistry between them was extremely obvious and strong. So I think that made a difference in how they presented the roles. Evan spent a lot of time with Jeff, getting to know him and getting to know some of his quirks and some of his expressions. And he did really well with that. At the after party, we were invited to that as well. And it was just, everybody was thrilled with the movie. I did not hear one single negative thing about it.
By any chance, was the question and answer session recorded so we could see it?
It is. I'll post it on Helen's Facebook page. It's on YouTube under TIFF, the Toronto International Film Festival. Tracy was also there, Helen's daughter, Lucas, Tracy's husband, Lily, Tracy's daughter. And after the premiere of the movie, we went to a stage. The way the film festival is set up, it's several blocks that are you know, blocked off for the week, and it's wonderful. And they have a stage set up for concerts. So after the premiere of the movie, we went to one of the stages, and there was a mini concert. Lily performed Revolution, the original song written for the movie. And there was a crowd sing-along of I Am Woman and other Helen hits, which was absolutely wonderful. And after that, we rushed to the after party. And after that, it was like 2 o'clock in the morning, and we just walked home, just glowing. It was just a wonderful, wonderful evening.
Now, you went to several other premieres as well, not just the Toronto one.
Well, I went to one more, the New York one, which was the Athena Film Festival. When the movie was going to be released, part of the issue was COVID, which has been a problem for a lot of movies and Hollywood in general. But so it couldn't be released in wide release in the theaters because they weren't showing it. So it was doing a lot of film festivals. And one of the ones was the Athena Film Festival, which is held at Columbia University in New York City. And we made that a fan club event, which means I got as many people to go as I possibly could. There were about 37 of us. I had posters made. I like to have things made to give out at the events that people can't get anywhere else. So I had posters made. I had pins made so that we were very identifiable as a group of Helen supporters. And after that, there was another reception, which we were all invited to at a place called Mel's Burger Bar. And I thought, Mel's Burger Bar. Now that sounds like, you know, a dive bar, which I love. So we went to Mel's before the show, so I'm familiar with the surroundings and everything. It is a wonderful place. They have wonderful food. And for the party, they had open bar and basically all the food we could eat for 3 hours. And again, at the end of the night, they played I Am Woman, and the restaurant was packed. I'm going to say maybe 350, 400 people singing I Am Woman at the top of our lungs. The power in that is just so strong. And I miss those times. I really do.
I want to ask you again about the husbands.
Mm-hmm.
There's just so much interest. And I think really it's because Helen in her book left so much out. Mm-hmm. So starting with husband number one, who was the father of Tracy.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever happened to him after she left Australia? Do you know?
His last name was Wheat, and they were together for about 5 years, and he had some health issues, and they divorced, and he eventually died. When Jeff, we know the story of Jeff, the third, Milton Ruth, was Helen's drummer for a long time, and he was almost, in my opinion, the extreme opposite of Jeff, where Jeff was assertive and in control. Milton was very accommodating and very inclusive, and he wanted to please people. He was just
mild-mannered?
He was very mild-mannered, and he just wanted to please people and just be somebody that you would like to sit down and talk with. And he was just that kind of person.
It sounds like you really liked him.
Oh, I really liked him. Yes, I knew him for about 7 years. And then after they got divorced, Milt went out of the business. He moved to Northern California, and we sort of lost touch. But he was a very nice man.
When you said that husband number one passed away, did he live long enough to see Helen become famous?
No, he didn't.
So he died very, very young.
He died young. He was older than Helen. I'm around twice her age. She used to say that in Australia, and it's so funny because it's the same way in my culture in West Virginia. If you don't have a child by the time you're 21, then life is over. You may as well just write it off. So she married very young and then was divorced after about 5 years, and then he died shortly after.
So it's probably fair to say that Jeff Wald is the only father Tracy really ever knew.
I would, and Jeff, yes, treated Tracy as his biological daughter. There has never been any question that Jeff is Tracy's father.
Do you think in writing the book, when Helen was referring to Jeff and possibly husband number one, that she was mindful of the impact on her children of anything she might say about Jeff?
I do. One time we were talking about the book, and I said, well, how do you decide exactly what to put in a book when there is so much to say? And she said one of her goals was to make sure that she didn't hurt anybody, that she wasn't going to be doing anything that would hurt somebody's feelings or hurt someone. So she was very conscious of that. And I think she did.
I wonder if she realized that she was leaving so many questions unanswered.
I think she did realize that.
I mean, she didn't explain at all why marriage number three didn't work out.
Right.
And from what you say about him, it doesn't sound like there's an obvious reason either.
Well, I think they just grew apart. I think it was just, it was amicable. There was no fighting. There was no arguing. It was just, we're done. Let's just call it a day.
Do you know if husband number three has made any public statement after Helen's passing?
I haven't seen any, and I haven't heard from him. And I know some of the other musicians that were in the band when he was the drummer, and none of them have heard from him either.
Well, now I would like to ask you about Helen's stage career, because there was a lengthy and very productive stage career that many people are not aware of. And I wondered if you could share some insights with us about which plays she did and anything you know about them.
And I have notes so that I get this right, because there was so many of them. Well, first of all, she did two productions of Blood Brothers, which is a wonderful play. That was, she made her Broadway debut.
Living on the never, never, constant as the changing weather, never sure who's at the door, or the price I'll have to pay. Should we meet again, I will not recognize your name. You can be sure what's gone before will be concealed. Your friends will never learn that once we were.
She had done two West End productions in London, one in the West End and one in North England before that. And she ran on Broadway from January of 95 to the end of April of 95. It was, as I've said before, one of the most powerful performances I have ever seen anybody give. And I've seen a lot of plays and I've seen a lot of performances, but her heart was in that story. The story basically is a woman who is raising her kids on her own, and she has twins and she can't keep both of them. So she gives one, finds a home for one. And the story is that later in life, the boys meet and they fall in love with the same girl, and it's not a happy ending. So at the end of the song, when Helen sings, "Tell Me It's Not True," both of her sons are lying dead at her feet. So it's not, you know, an uplifting story. I saw it 17 times. And she used to say, "I don't know why you're doing that. The story's not going to end. The ending is not going to change." And I said, "I keep hoping one of them is going to get up." But
what
after
do
she
you think drew her to such a dark story?
I think it was the music. The music is wonderful, and it gave her a chance to sing some very powerful songs, like "Tell Me It's Not True" is just one. She also did Shirley Valentine. She did five productions of that, which was also written by Willie Russell. And the interesting thing about Shirley Valentine is she did that all over the country. She did it in, well, she did it in Toronto at this Stage West Theater, which was wonderful. She was there for a week. And then after she did it there, she came back and did a concert. We were there for all the shows. She did it in Rhode Island. She did it all throughout the Midwest and the Upper Northwest. She did it in Albuquerque. She did it all over the place. And it was one of the most wonderful examples of a one-woman show I have ever seen. I don't know how she remembered all those lines. And she's talking constantly with one intermission. And that story is another one that she identified with, I think, because it's a story of a woman who realizes that her life is based on the roles that she plays in relation to other people in her life. She's a wife, she's a mother, she's the person who does the cooking, the cleaning, and all of that. And she says, "No, I'm not happy with this. I used to be Shirley Valentine. I want to be Shirley Valentine again." And so the second half of the story is her rediscovering and reasserting herself, which is so wonderful for Helen to do.
So now, there's no music in Shirley Valentine, correct?
Correct.
And it's, the Blood Brothers, is there a soundtrack cast album that she's on?
No, there is a cast album, but she's not on it, which really, I really wish they would release one with her on it. But I don't always get my wishes, obviously.
Did she do other plays as well?
Yes, she did one called Love, Julie, which was that only, she did two productions of that. That was in Connecticut, the Westport Playhouse and the Sharon Playhouse. That was a story of two female friends, one of whom has a little bit of a drinking problem. That was another good story for Helen. There's no music in that. She did for Sacramento Music Circus and for the Long Beach Civic Light Opera, she did Anything Goes, Call Me Madam, and The Mystery of Edwin Drood. She loved doing those because it was older music, well, especially the first two, Call Me Madam and Anything Goes, older music, which she loved. She got to wear all those wonderful costumes. And like with all the other plays, it's an ensemble. It's not just her carrying the show. She's the star, but there's an ensemble that she gets to work with. And one of the things that I think people don't understand is contracts. Like for instance, with Blood Brothers, Petula Clark did it first on Broadway, and then with the Cassidy Brothers, and then Carole King did it. The contracts are for a certain amount of time. So Petula's ended, Carole signed a contract to do it for a period of time, and then Helen signed a contract to do it for a period of time. And one of the things that I love that they did, the doorman, who was just a wonderful person, had about 12 kids. I could be a little off on that number, but he had a lot of kids and he died unexpectedly. And the cast of Blood Brothers, including Petula, Carole, and Helen, did a concert to benefit his family, and all the proceeds went to his family. It was it was another one of those times where you see the heart of the performers doing something directly for somebody that's going to make a big difference.
And no video.
But I was backstage after when Carol was there and Petula was there and Helen was there, and they were friends. They were friendly. They were there for a purpose. And it was just wonderful to see. You know, a lot of times you get stars or people who think they're more important than somebody else, who, no, it's all about me. I need the bigger dressing room and all that. There was none of that. It was just a wonderful, wonderful thing to see.
How lucky you were to witness some of these moments. That'll never happen again.
That'll never happen again. And had Helen not been a part of my life, they wouldn't have happened the first time. So well, I am conscious of that all the time.
My next question has to do with her outlook with respect to her legacy. You know, she was interviewed numerous times at different stages in her life, and sometimes the answers to the same question would be different. Mm-hmm. And one of the questions that kept coming back to me, when she was asked how she wanted to be remembered, there are different answers, ranging from, I don't care if I'm remembered at all, to something much more positive. Can you just share with us what was going on in her life that she would say, I don't care if I'm remembered at all? And well, what changed when she started to give a much more holistic and a positive response?
That was one of the questions I get a lot. And when Helen first retired, she needed, in my opinion, she needed a break from the constant touring, the constant pulling, the constant somebody asking for something, the constant, we need you to perform here, we want you to perform there. And it started to become a burden, I think. So when she retired, when she said, I'm done with this, I am truly done with this. I am not going to talk about it. I don't want to hear about it. And let me just move on with my life. So I wrote these down so I would have them, the exact quote of what she said, so to make sure that I'm, you know, reflecting this correctly. With the interview that she did in Australia, where she's in her apartment and she's on the balcony and she was asked, how do you want to be remembered? Her answer was, I don't care if I'm remembered or not. The important thing is that any good that I've done lives on. So I think that what she was saying there was, let's not focus on me. Let's focus on whatever good I've done and let it go at that. We don't even have to talk about me anymore. But then later on in life, when she was back to performing and she was in a different frame of mind, and she was more relaxed about performing and doing what she wanted to do, the answer she gave is the one that I love. She said, I want to be remembered as being kind. I'm sorry. I want to be remembered as being kind. After all, that's what love is, essentially. And I think that was Helen.
I think that came across in the way she presented herself, especially in her final years.
I do too. And just having seen how, and I've said this so many times, but how she treated people, how she treated kids, how she treated animals, how she treated people that might need a hand, how she treated people in the business who weren't getting the exposure that maybe they should be or she could help with. She wanted to bring them up, give them a chance. And a lot of those people opened for her. So a lot of comedians, before they made it big, opened for her. A lot of singers opened for her. So she was truly a woman who practiced what she preached.
I want to ask you, Jim, so many people have this in their minds. You were an extremely close friend of Helen's for 50 plus years. How are you managing the grief and the mourning when you spend so much of your time immersed in the memories of Helen? How are you doing? How do you deal with this?
Well, you know, that's one of the questions I ask myself, and I am no doctor, but I have had more than my share of grief in my life. Both parents have died. And within the last 5 years, I've lost 3 siblings, 3 cousins, and Helen, and both in-laws. So the one thing that I have learned about grief more than anything else is that people grieve differently. And you need to do it in your own time and in your own way. Some people, for me, doing what I'm doing and sort of immersing myself in Helen and going through the memories and remembering all of the good times, I'm sort of refusing to focus on the one event that broke my heart, the fact that she's gone.
But that was one moment. That doesn't erase a whole lifetime of memories and of good deeds and remarkable performances.
Exactly, and that's what I'm focusing on. All of those moments that make my life what it is, so many of them involve Helen, and so many of them I would have not had it not been for her. So it's sort of unfair to her memory and to our relationship to be angry, and anger is a part of grief, but to be angry that she left when I wasn't ready for her to leave. But I would never be ready for her to leave. And one of the things that I tell people all the time is Helen was my dear friend and I loved her dearly, but the grief and the pain that I am experiencing has absolutely no comparison at all to the depth of the pain and the grief that Tracy and Jordan and Tony and Lily are experiencing. This is their mother, their sister, their grandmother, their Nana. This is a hole that cannot be filled by anybody ever again. So not that the hole in my heart can be filled either, but it's not the same kind of hole. So when one of the things I try not to do, and at the beginning when I talked to Tracy and Jordan and Lily, I would say, how are you doing? And I meant that is how are you, is there anything I can do? Do you need to talk? I've sort of stopped saying it like that because I know, or at least I understand. I don't know what they're going through, but I understand what they're going through. And sometimes I don't know how I'm doing. I don't know. I just am angry. I'm upset. I'm crying. I don't know why. It's little things like that, that the grieving process has to happen and you have to go through. My caution to people, though, who are grieving is if it takes over your life, if you get depressed, you can't get out of bed, and you can't do anything other than think about the person who has passed, please seek some advice, some therapy, some counseling. I did, and it made a huge difference for me. My mother's death changed me incredibly. I lost my innocence the day she died, and I knew that the worst could happen and would be happening again. And I needed some help in dealing with that.
What do you make of the grief that so many fans have? These are people that never met her. They certainly didn't have the insight into her life that you had. Although now we're beginning to get, thanks to your generosity, we all are feeling much closer to her. But are you surprised by the reaction? Because you are inundated with emails and messages from fans.
No, I'm not surprised at all. And that's one of the questions I get quite frequently is, why am I so upset about the death of a person that I don't even know? Well, I think part of that is that we're defining no too narrowly. I don't know you personally. I don't know your life, but I know the impact you've had on my life. The words to Helen's songs, that her example of her life, her kindness, her generosity, seeing her, and a lot of people, and especially during times of depression and anxiety, and especially for gay people, lesbians, and people who are marginalized, they didn't have anybody else to turn to, so they turned to singers. And Helen was one of the ones that was the strongest. So people like strong singers. And I don't know what it is about strong female singers, but it's the sort of the role model, and especially for marginalized people. So what I tell people is you are experiencing a normal emotion. The person that you turn to, even though you still have the music, you know is gone. And she may be strong, she may be invincible, and she may be woman, but she wasn't infallible. She was human, which means that she was going to die at some point, as we all are. And so I don't think it's unreasonable at all or unrealistic to be experiencing the loss of somebody that you've never met because they've had such an impact on your life. It's so strange that that question comes up because I have met so many people through Helen who were in my childhood on TV and just part of my childhood. One of them who just recently died, and I knew her for maybe 6 years. Dina Dietrich, who was Mother Nature in the It's Not Nice to Fool Mother Nature commercials. We became very close. She was another one that was just a wonderful person. First time I met her, she held my hand and she said, "You know, I'm never going to let go of you." And it was like, oh my God. And when she died, the last thing she said to me the last time we visited her was she held my hand, she kissed me, and she said, "You know, I'm never going to let go of you." I only knew her for 6 years, but that hurt when she died.
Do you understand the magnitude of the impact you have, that you are now being seen as the person people can connect to if they want to feel closer to Helen and know more about her? You've become much, much more visible on an international scale since she died. Are you ready for it? And how do you feel about it?
Well, I'm ready for it because in effect, I've been doing it basically my entire life. I have been interacting with fans of Helen's. It's just now she's not there. So I am, for lack of a better word, a substitute. Helen used to have a phrase that I really liked. She said that a lot of people in the business, and a lot of fans for that matter, didn't want to know her. They didn't want to be around her. They wanted to be her. And I never thought about that. And I don't want that to happen with me. I don't want people to resent the relationship that I had with Helen or try to detract from it, because my relationship was my relationship. It has nothing to do with them or their lack of a relationship or the relationship that they wish they had or any of that. I am more than willing to share my experiences and my love for Helen and my thoughts about her and her life, but I want it to be done in a happy way. I don't want it to be done in a way that's perceived as boastful or holding it over somebody. I don't want that.
I don't think anybody who has watched these interviews or knows you or has read anything you've written could ever accuse you of that. You have perpetuated her memory in the most dignified and the most respectful way towards her, her children, her work, her legacy. I think that what you've done by allowing us to have this window into her life and career has been remarkable. And on that note, we're running out of time. I hope that everyone watching has enjoyed this conversation as much as I have. I don't know if there'll be a part four, Jim, but would you be up for it if we get a lot of requests?
I'm ready when you are.
Well, you are an absolute delight. You are such a prince among men. It's such a joy to interview you. I want to give a special shout out to our producer, Steve, who sets up all the techie stuff.
Yes.
I want to thank your husband, Mark, for freeing you up for all of this time. And if there's an interest in a part four, we've heard it from Jim himself. He's willing to do it. So I hope that everyone's enjoyed this session with Jim Keaton, president of the official Helen Reddy fan club. Jim, thank you so, so much for your honesty, your openness, your inclusivity, your generosity of spirit, your warmth. It really comes through on the screen. And I think that's one of the reasons why we are getting this incredibly overwhelming deluge of positive feedback. It's you, Jim.
Well, thank you. And I am thrilled to do it and keep listening to the best.
We sure will. Thank you, everybody, for listening.
Thanks for watching. Be sure to check out all the great interviews on the Harvey Brownstone Interviews YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell to be notified when new videos are posted.